Today we want to continue with Global Health Series number 14. We are talking about life expectancy. And the countries we want to discuss today will be number 121 to 130. Country number 121 is Cape Verde, with a life expectancy of 71.61. We have Vietnam, number 122 among the countries, with a life expectancy of 71.58. 123 among the countries is Nicaragua, with a life expectancy of 71.50. 124 is Palau, with a life expectancy of 71.22. Marshall Island is number 125, with a life expectancy of 71.19. Syria is number 126, with a life expectancy of 71.18. Iran is 127, with a life expectancy of 71.14. The Philippines is 71.09 years, numbering about 128 among countries. 129 is Federal State of Micronesia, with 70.94. And finally, for today, we have number 130, which is Trinidad and Tobago, with a life expectancy of 70.86. Then we have the social determinants, which we've been talking about, and we have to discuss seven of them today. The first one is increasing access to medical care. If you go around countries in this world globally, you see that not every country has good access to medical care. It's either a country complaining of the cost of medical care, access, or the quality. I will use the United States as an example, where technology has helped immensely. And you see even great leaders from other countries coming to access medical care. Before the Obamacare, 49 million people were uninsured in this country, United States. So you would imagine what will happen in Chad or Somalia, or South Africa and some of these other countries. If the population cannot access medical care, then it becomes difficult for them to live long. You see such countries having men and women die at the age of 40 or 50 or even 30. So it's necessary where policymakers are discussing, they have to be serious with increasing access to medical care. Each and everyone in a country is supposed to have access, so that when health prevention didn't work, we can at least access medical care to be able to live long. Apart from increasing access to medical care, we have population health. The population health of a country could be measured when you get into that country, you look at the kind of population the country has, how many people are sick, how many people are in hospital. If a country is sickly, you will know. Most countries around 200 plus are those that have a lot of sick people, and of course, you should not expect their life expectancy to be more than 40 years. We also have traditional approach to health. There are countries that still believe in traditional approach. And because of this approach, a lot of people suffer in these countries. Sometimes when a woman is pregnant and is about to deliver, you'll be so afraid because they use traditional approach and you don't know which way that woman will go. That is where it is scary. That even when people are using their traditional approach, they should not discard the modern medicine, because that will save a greater number of lives. Number four is the upstream determinants. By upstream determinants, I'm talking of children unborn. How do you care for them? How do you provide for them? How do you make provision so that when they are born, they are taken care of from infancy until they get to kindergarten, then to primary school, high school, and to colleges. If you do this, if a child is well taken care of, you expect that child to live longer. Otherwise, if no attention is paid to children born in exactly a lot of all these West African countries, you expect those people to die even as babies. Where there is upstream determinants, you discover that the people are likely to have a healthy population. Then the downstream determinants or downstream interventions. When people are careless, they don't care what happens to the next person, then it becomes detrimental to that population, because that will be a sickly population. And a sickly population is a non-productive population. They are not adding anything to the economic system. And the economy of a country, once it is bad and cannot get out of that kind of difficulty, will continue to remain down there. Of course, there is necessity for health, education. People need to be trained. Health officials, public health officials, those who take care of hygiene. I remember in those days, even in my country, we used to have hygiene inspectors, hygiene officers. And when they are coming, in fact, in villages or compounds, people will be running helter-skelter to ensure that they are not convicted. So it's necessary we have health education in our communities, in our villages, in our population, and the entire society. Where there is adequate health education, you expect the people to live longer. And finally, health promotion. Developed countries like America, Norway, Japan, Sweden, they all sink a lot of money into health promotion. Because some people are so adamant that even when you are crying and telling them this is the way to go, they will not listen. So that is why it is necessary we have health promotion. Through health promotion and health education, we can have enough interventions. And once we have interventions, it means that population is taken care of and people there will live longer. So we want to end it today, but let it be understood that it is necessary for us to talk of life health prevention even before talking of curative. That will help this globe to have people who will live longer in their different countries. And it is only by so doing that the life expectancy in all these countries will be meaningful. Thank you.